Dr. Sanjeev Rao is going to talk on current indications for surgery in mitral and aortic wall disease and role of biomarkers. Okay.
Dr. Sanjeev Rao is a senior consultant from Hyderabad.
Latest slides. Respected chairperson, distinguished audience, colleagues and friends, a very good morning. It is more of an accident than an incident that I'm here. A couple of days back, I called up Dr. Mohanty. I wanted to sit in the audience, but he said that there is a slot that I should speak. So I really thank Dr. Suresh Rao, Dr. Mohanty, for giving me an opportunity. You should pardon me for poor quality slides, because since morning we have seen a lot of colorful slides, the normal natural anatomy, and then talk by distinguished radiologist, and now we are entering into the clinical application part after the anatomy and the diagnosis. Now there is a lot of importance for this topic, because no artificial valve can duplicate a natural valve, and so far no artificial valve could has been manufactured which could give the ideal hemodynamics and a long standing result. So we should know that when we should intervene in the natural process of the disease, because valvular disease is a progressive disease, and unless we understand the natural history of the disease, we do not know where to intervene, because and the disease will be progressing, and it progresses symptomatic from asymptomatic to asymptomatic disease. Because unless we understand the natural history, if we intervene too early in the natural course of disease, we are trying to actually put a disease into an already existing disease. We are replacing a disease by a disease, because prosthetic valves or repair operations do have problems. So we should know that our operative procedure or a replacement would give a better result than the natural course of disease. So that is the reason we should know when we have to intervene in the course of disease. And it should not be too late, that already there is a lot of damage to the heart and the body organs. To understand this, we should know the progression of the disease from stage A to stage D. By definition, stage A is at risk. That is, patient has a normal valve, but who has a tendency to develop a progressive disease like a bicuspid aortic valve. Stage B is progressive valve disease, where there is mild to moderate severity but no clinical symptoms. Stage 3 is asymptomatic severe valve disease. This is of importance, and that my talk would concentrate on this subset of the group of patients, because there is the pathology has already progressed to a severe disease and patient is asymptomatic. So this consists of two groups. C1, stage C1 is asymptomatic with severe, in which the ventricular function remains normal, and C2 is asymptomatic with severe ventricular with decompensation of the ventricle. Even though there is decompensation in C2 group, stage C2, the patient is still asymptomatic. And in stage D is asymptomatic. We know very well that all the symptomatic patients need surgery or intervention, whatever. We should also know that the risks involved in the operative procedure to make a decision. So risk assessment, this is the recommendation in 2014 guidelines of valvular heart diseases, which combines the STS prediction of risk of mortality and morbidity, which also includes frailty, major organ system compromise, involving one or other more organs and procedure specific impediments. There are a lot of slides, so I'll just brush through and try to focus mostly on the important topics. Before this, I would like to say about the classification of the recommendations. Class 1 recommendation is one where the benefit of a procedure is more than the risk, so a procedure should be performed. And class 2 has class 2A and class 2B, where class 2A is benefit of a procedure is more than risk and it is reasonable to perform a procedure. Class 2B is a benefit is equivalent or more than risk and may be considered. Class 3 is there is no benefit or a procedure may be harmful. And the level of evidence for these procedures is level A, level B, and level C. Level A is the data derived from multiple high-quality randomized controlled trials. Class B is multiple moderate quality randomized trials. Type B, non-randomized trials, NR, and level C is only non-randomized limited data. And level C is only case studies or expert opinions. I'll start with the most commonest problem in the valvular heart disease, that is mitral stenosis. This is a very innocuous disease which has a very slow progression, and by the time patient becomes symptomatic, there is already a lot of damage to the heart and the pulmonary vasculature. And the conventional indications have been only in symptomatic patients. But with the onset of the low-risk percutaneous procedures with better benefit, the indications guidelines have changed. The class C here is asymptomatic severe mitral stenosis. Conventionally, in the conventional teaching, the severe mitral stenosis was considered when the mitral valve area was less than 1 square centimeter or the diastolic pressure half times was more than 150. But with the onset of these percutaneous techniques, the mitral valve area to consider a severe MS has been reduced to 1.5 square centimeter and the diastolic pressure half times to more than 150 milliseconds. That is because to include in the percutaneous procedures most of these cases. The recommendations for class 1 recommendations for intervention in the mitral valve disease. Mitral valve surgery is indicated in stage D. That is, stage D is severely symptomatic, and when the mitral valve area is less than 1.5 square centimeter, and who are not high risk for surgery, or primarily who have had an attempted PTMC and have failed a percutaneous balloon valvotomy. And another indication for class 1 is concomitant mitral valve surgery in the presence of severe mitral stenosis C or D with favorable morphology in the absence of contraindications. Now we go to the 2A recommendations where the benefit of the procedure is better than the risk and it is reasonable to perform. In this, mitral valve surgery is reasonable in severely symptomatic stage D with other operative indications like a aortic valve procedure. And stage 2A, another indication is in stage D patients, that is with mitral valve area less than 1.5 NHY class 3 and 4, where there are other operative indications. The mitral valve, I'm not talking on the percutaneous, I concentrate on the surgery part. Mitral valve may be considered in patients with moderate mitral stenosis, that is valve area of 1.6 to 2 square centimeters, who are who have another indication for surgery, like an aortic valve surgery, that becomes a 2B indication, where the benefit of the procedure is equivalent to the risk. So the procedure may be considered. The last, another indication for mitral valve surgery is recurrent thromboembolism in spite of anticoagulation in a patient with class C or class D. This is a flow chart of indication for surgery or intervention, which I've actually already discussed. One thing I would like to focus is, there is a group of patients of mitral valve area more than 1.5, pressure half time more than less than 150 milliseconds, symptoms with no other cause, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure more than 25 with exercise. This is the patients in whom, actually in my later part of the talk, the role of biomarkers, which I am to focus, where a patient who is asymptomatic at rest, but on exertion, he becomes symptomatic and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure increases to more than 25. It is in these patients that the biomarkers are useful. Another topic of a lot of interest and debate is patient with primary mitral regurgitation, where the regurgitation is because purely to the pathology of the mitral valve, chordae, papillary muscle, or the leaflet, annulus. So it is this group where the grade C group, which is of a lot of focus now. If you see the stages of progression, up to stage C, the patients are asymptomatic. In stage C, patient is asymptomatic, but if you see the echocardiographic hemodynamic data, it fits into all the criteria required for a severe aortic mitral regurgitation, like a central jet more than 40% of the left atrial, holocystic eccentric mitral regurgitation, vena contractile of more than 0.7, regurgitant volume of more than 50, regurgitation fraction of more than 50, effective regurgitant orifice area of more than 0.4, and if you see the angiographic criteria, it is grade 3 and grade 4. It is into this group that there are two subgroups, once again, of great focus of late, the C1 and C2. The C1 stage grade of disease is where left ventricular ejection fraction is more than 60 and left ventricular end systolic dimension is less than 40. And in C2, the patient is asymptomatic, but left ventricular ejection fraction is less than 60 and left ventricular end systolic dimension more than 40. Even though the ventricular function is more than 60, already the patient with a mitral regurgitation is into a severe disease, because in the presence of a mitral regurgitation, the ventricular function gives a fallacious indication. Obviously, the stage grade D or stage D is symptomatic patients who have decreased effort tolerance. So when do we intervene in a patient with a chronic primary mitral regurgitation, where the pathology is restricted to the mitral valve and its apparatus? The class 1 indications are in a patient with the stage D, already symptomatic, with ventricular ejection fraction more than 30. Class 2, class 1, another indication is mitral valve is recommended in asymptomatic patients with ventricular function more than 30 to 60 who have severe primary MR, that is stage C2. C1 is with normal ventricular function, C2 is with ventricular dysfunction. Mitral valve is recommended in preference to mitral valve replacement when surgical treatment is indicated for patients with chronic severe primary mitral regurgitation limited to posterior, because this is one subset, because the repair of a posterior leaflet pathology has been gold standard and the results are predictable. The results in a repair of a posterior leaflet, like triangular resection, quadrangular resection, these give a predictable results of over 95% to 97% in the best hands. So it becomes a class one indication. And mitral valve repair is recommended in preference to mitral valve regurgitation when the pathology is restricted to anterior or both leaflets in centers of excellence. That means centers who do valve repairs regularly and who can predict a 95% result and mortality of less than 2%. Another indication for mitral valve repair or replacement is in a patient with chronic severe primary MR who undergo cardiac surgery for other reasons, who fall into class C, stage C. Coming to 2A recommendations where the benefit is more than risk and the procedure is reasonable to perform, that is this subset of patients where class C1, where the ventricular function is preserved and the ventricular end systolic dimension is less than 40, and in whom the success and durable of repair, as I said, the result should be 95%, then it becomes a 2A and it should be performed in center of excellence. Another indication for 2A is in a patient with C1, that is with preserved ventricular function, and there is a high likelihood of a successful and a durable repair, or patient with onset of atrial fibrillation or resting pulmonary hypertension. Another indication in 2A is concomitant mitral valve repair in stage B, that is moderate mitral regurgitation in the presence of another valvular lesion. The indications in stage 2B or mitral valve surgery may be considered in symptomatic patients, that is stage D, with less than 30% EF. That is stage D, this carries high mortality. So the benefit of a procedure is balanced that of the risk. So it becomes a stage 2B. Another indication for in 2B is mitral valve repair may be considered in patient with rheumatic valve disease when the treatment is indicated where durable and successful repair is likely. The reason is the results of mitral valve repair in rheumatic population is not very good. Long-term results are not very good except in experts' hands. So it becomes a stage 2B. I'd like to fastly brush through. These are the 2014 guidelines, which I've already mentioned. The next topic is on secondary mitral regurgitation, where the pathology is primarily because of a ventricular problem. Either it can be an ischemic ventricular pathology or an idiopathic ventricular pathology, and the mitral valve primarily remains normal. It is in this group that the treatment is very controversial, and I would not touch on this topic because there's a lot of discussion, lot of debate on how to manage an ischemic mitral pathology. But the guidelines say that symptomatic severe MR who is in stage D, who present in the surgery indication for surgery becomes a class 2B indication, because even if we repair the reflet, try to repair the valve, correct the regurgitation, the pathology in the ventricle remains. So we may not give an adequate result because the pathology in the mitral muscle, myocardial muscle remains. And hence it becomes a 2B indication. For the same reason, any stage C patient should be just periodically monitored and treated for the heart failure. And even in stage B with progressive, the patient should be periodically monitored rather than correcting the mitral valve pathology. In the for a secondary mitral mitral regurgitation, the 2A indication become it's reasonable for patient with class stage C and D who are undergoing a concomitant CABG on AVR. If a patient who can be revascularized in the presence of a severe mitral regurgitation, which is secondary to an ischemic pathology, it becomes a 2A indication. But still the level of evidence is still C. That is, it is only out of non-randomized limited data or expert opinion or case reports. Now the latest guideline on 2017, it is reasonable to choose caudal sparing mitral mitral valve replacement or downsizing angioplasty repair in stage D and symptomatic class 3 and 4 for patients in spite of symptomatic, in spite of guideline recommended medical management. It is this patient that we know that preserving the mitral valve apparatus or totally preserving the whole of the mitral valve apparatus or trying to preserve the papillary muscle caudal apparatus, the results are better. Immediate and long-term results are better even in secondary mitral regurgitation. So it becomes a 2A recommendations from the recent 2017 guideline. In another indication is in patients with chronic severe MR, stage C and D who are the same thing. 2B indication is mitral valve surgery may be considered for severely symptomatic class stage D patients. It becomes a 2B indications. It cannot be a 1 or a 2 in 2A indication. The other indication is stage B, that is secondary MR patients undergoing for other cardiac like aortic valve or a coronary revascularization. Another topic of interest is aortic stenosis in an asymptomatic patient with severe aortic stenosis. The up to the stage C, the patients have mild to moderate aortic stenosis determined by peak velocity across the valve of 2 to 2.9 or a mean peak gradient of less than 20. And by the time the patient reaches C, it becomes severe with aortic valve flows of more than 4 meters per second and gradient of more than 40, mean gradient more than 40, and an aortic valve area of less than 1. But the patient in C group is asymptomatic in spite of having the severe disease by echocardiographically. These patients with C1 and C2, in C1, the ventricular function is normal. And in C2, the ventricular function, there is ventricular dysfunction, that is ejection fraction is less than 50. So this is group of patient, because conventionally we know that a patient has to be operated for an aortic stenosis if he becomes symptomatic. This is the conventional teaching. But if you see this patient group of patients in C1 and C2, they have already a severe disease. The ventricular has already started deteriorating. So we have to move away from the conventional teaching of practice of the stage D as an indication. And it is here that once again that the biomarkers are helpful and exercise testing are helpful. And we know in my coming topic, the role of biomarkers where it is much better than the exercise testing. The stage D is once again divided into stage D1, D2, and D3. This is once again focused because of the introduction of the percutaneous procedure, that is the TAVR. So now that that procedure is gaining importance, we have to know about this, what is D1, D2, D3. D1 is symptomatic patient with a severe high-grade aortic stenosis with high gradient and a valve area of less than 1 square centimeter. And the patient already has diastolic dysfunction, ventricular hypertrophy. D2 is low flow, low gradient aortic stenosis. This is because of ventricular dysfunction that the patient has an aortic value of less than 1 square centimeter, but his gradients are less than 40, his resting flow velocities are less than 4 meters per second. This is this patient. To identify this patient, a dobutamine echo stress test has to be done, and if the gradients increase more than 40 or the flow velocity goes more than 4 meters per second, these are the patients who benefit from the surgery. And these patients have already have systolic and diastolic dysfunction. The interesting group of patients is stage D3, who have a aortic valve area less than 1 square centimeter, aortic valve flow velocity is less than 4. The reason is these patients have a small ventricle, small chambered ventricle, and these patients have low stroke volume index. The present day recommendations for aortic valve surgery or aortic valve replacement, the class one is any patient in stage D1. That is high flow, high gradient. And stage C2 with ventricular ejection fraction less than 50, that is the ventricular dysfunction already set in. Stage C or D, with any patient with C or D who have to undergo concomitant surgery for another reason, that is an aortic valve or a coronary revascularization. Once the patient is in C1, that is his ventricular function is preserved, he becomes a 2A indication for surgery. Another indication for in 2A is a patient with C1 who has decreased exercise tolerance and exercise fallen blood pressure. It is in this, once again, that the biomarkers like BNP and proBNP, if their levels are high, it shows that the patient has already has ventricular dysfunction and he becomes an indication. Another indication for in 2A is any patient in stage D3, that is, I said, low stroke volume, low flow, low gradient, who have a ventricular function, who are normotensive and a ventricular function more than 50, he falls into 2A. Any patient with stage B, that is moderate aortic stenosis, with the aortic flow velocity of 3 to 3.9, who are undergoing cardiac surgery for other reasons, falls into 2A. The same flow chart. I know this topic is very boring because a lot of slides and but I'll try to brush through. Now that the introduction of the TAVR, the class one indications for TAVR is a patient with high surgical risk, that is stage D, D2, D3. These are the patients who fall into class one for a TAVR. And another group of patients is, I said about that high risk in STS and risk classification. Any patient who has a very high risk, prohibitively high risk, he falls into a stage one of a TAVR. And that these patients should have a predictable post-TAVR survival of more than 12 months. Now, another upcoming indication for a TAVR is it's an alternative to surgical aortic valve replacement in a high-risk surgical patient, even if he falls into class C.
2 minutes more?
Yeah, sure, sure. Aortic valve regurgitation, I'll jump on to the aortic valve. Stage A, stage B is mild and moderate. Stage C, this is another group of patients where there is already in the echocardiographic criteria of a severe aortic regurgitation by regurgitant volume more than 60, effective regurgitant orifice area, which has been the gold standard of more than 0.3, angiographic of 3 plus and 4, and holodiastolic reversal in the aorta. There are two subsets in this, that is C1 and C2. In C1, the ventricular function is normal, and the end systolic dimension is less than 50. And C2 is where the ventricle is already started deteriorating with ejection fraction, end-diastolic, end-systolic dimension more than 50. The class 1 recommendations for aortic valve replacement in aortic regurgitation is a stage D, stage C2, where there is ventricular dysfunction, and stage C or D, asymptomatic or symptomatic if they are concomitant indication for another valvular lesion or a coronary surgery. 2A and 2A recommendations, any patient with C2 with severe ventricular dilatation. And another group is a patient with moderate AR who are undergoing concomitant another valvular surgery or a coronary surgery. With a moderate AR, it becomes a 2A indication. I think I'll just few minutes on biomarkers, because I thought this should be of some interest, because as basically we are clinician surgeons, we show most of the time on surgery, and there is some upcoming data on this role of biomarkers. Conventionally, we have made the diagnosis of the valvular lesions on echocardiography. But there are certain limitations, that is, it's an operator dependent, and at times that the patient will not get a good echo window, and we need another modality to assess the severity of the valve lesions. And we also need other objective measures to assess the severity so that we can make a plan of management. The list of biomarkers is something like this, but it is only a limited one. There's plenty. The one of importance are brain natriuretic factor as BNP, N-terminal part of BNP as NT-BNP, precursor or pro-BNP. These are the of importance. Cardiotropin 1, tumor necrosis receptor, factor receptor 1 and 2. I'll just first tell about this. Tumor necrosis factor 1 and 2 have been of importance in the progression of aortic sclerodegenerative aortic valve disease. Cardiotropin 1 is a factor which is released by the cardiac muscle myocyte in response to the stress, either it is a volume or a pressure overload, and which indicates that there is already a damage to the structure of the sarcomere arrangement. So a patient, once he starts developing a ventricular dilatation in the presence of a pressure or a volume overload, the cardiotropin is released. The arrangement of the sarcomeres in the myocardial muscle changes. It becomes a series arrangement, and this leads to fibrosis and clerical and deterioration. I think I'll stop my topic. Some other time, if I get, I'll talk on these biomarkers. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sorry,
I thank you, Dr. Rao. Yeah.